time is a concept that's fascinated philosophers and thinkers throughout history. The 5th century Greek philosopher Heraclitus said, "Time is a game played beautifully by children." Albert Einstein said, "Time is an illusion." We've never really understood what it was, and least of all, understood what it is in complex systems. This project seeks to develop models and tools and frameworks to address the many faces of time in the worlds that we live in. So the arrow of time traditionally refers to the increase of entropy or disorder in a closed system. The adaptive arrow of time relates to the increase in order that's functional in an open system. In complex systems, there are multiple arrows of time. There's an arrow of time in your cell. There's an arrow of time in a kidney. There's an arrow of time in an ecosystem. And those are the complex arrows of time. They integrate over many adaptive arrows of time. The adaptive arrow of time relies on entropy because the increase in order in a complex system has to correspond to an increase of disorder in the world. And so this project seeks to bring all of those arrows together, and we call that complex time. One of the foundational differences between complex systems and simple physical systems in relation to time is that complex systems can perceive time. Whereas a solar system, for example, or a planet exists within time, and we explain processes, for example, of radioactive decay as unfolding in time, there's no sense in which that system encodes time and uses it adaptively. An issue that everyone cares about is whether failure of a system is gradual or catastrophic. It's a given that we're going to die, but it's not clear how. Can we maintain function almost impeccably and perfectly for a long period of time and then collapse quickly? Or do we have to degrade painfully and slowly? We have no theory for that. And this is an area that we are actively working on in relation to brain function. Could you maintain almost perfect brain function up until the end, or is senescence inevitable? Can we control how long we live? Could we predict and intervene to ensure that a company would survive many more years? Do we know when our civilization is going to come to an end? Are there early warning signs? And if we can detect them, are there mechanisms that we could deploy to change the trajectory of the system? One obvious difference between the aging of technology and aging in biology is that technology tends to accumulate more error, whereas biology tends to eliminate error through death and extinction. So when you consider software, every time there's a bug, you don't throw away all the software, you add a patch. And so an interesting question is, does software and technology age in a fundamentally different way from biological species and biological organisms, because you can't afford to throw everything away, because you have to work with what you have and fix it. And that leads to extraordinarily messy and kludgy systems, which makes technology and society look a little different from the biological world. Another important difference in the aging of society and organisms is that societies are made up of many organisms, all contributing ideas, all contributing technologies. And so we have to have a collective theory of aging, not just an individual theory. And that's something that we certainly don't yet have. One very intriguing similarity between, for example, the power grid and the nervous system is that catastrophic failure in both cases can be explained by contagion across networks. And so in both of those cases, in one case you have systems of electrical connections, and the other ones axons and synapses, damage propagates across the neural net or the power grid, taking down individual components in a very statistically regular way. So that when you look at these two systems through the appropriate mathematical lens, they look very similar. We're very interested in partnering with individuals or labs or institutions who have highly resolved temporal data that contain some signature of the arrows of time. We're looking for economists, archaeologists, anthropologists, computer scientists, mathematicians, physicists, and so on, all who can come together and explore the way time plays out in a variety of different complex systems. Because we have all of these different communities working together, we can begin to ask how time in one system relates to time in another. For example, what is the relationship between sleep and susceptibility to disease? What's the relationship between brain failure and sleep? What's the relationship between the perception of time and the structure of our society? So there are all these much larger questions that we can begin to address that could not be addressed in a disciplinary fashion as a consequence of having all of these communities working together to discover the core patterns in their data and the common tools that they can employ. In some sense, what we need is to extend statistical mechanics to include heterogeneity and adaptive processes. And this is a huge challenge because the tendency has been to use the tools that we have on problems where they're not a very good fit. And so a big part of our initiative has been to bring together theorists who are willing to explore the full richness of the data and develop new tools and frameworks that are adequate to explain the regularities that we observe.